And joining us this morning, we have Senate Finance Committee Chairman Sunny Angara. Senator Angara, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning to your viewers.
All right, Senator, let's start with politics first. At one point, you did declare support for Sara Duterte if she ran for the presidency. Does that still stand?
Yes, if she would run, I think we would support her, Karen. But okay. let's wait because we're not sure yet. We're not sure if she's running, for which position she's running.
Mm-mm. Okay, Congressman Suarez floated the idea of term sharing for the presidency. Is this constitutionally possible?
It's quite unusual arrangement because you know, there's only one name on the ballot that people are allowed to vote for. So I don't know if that that might be questioned, you know.
Okay, moving to the budget. How would you describe the budget submitted by Malacañang?
Well, the budget was pre-Delta, let's remember, no? There's a budget process in the year. So, you know, the early in the year, first, second quarter, the DBM or the Department of Budget asks the different departments or agencies of government, may yung tinatawag na budget call, Karen, meaning mag-submit kayo ng budget, ano yung mga priority projects niyo. And they're the ones who collate all the budgets, and they're the ones who make the final decisions for the executive branch. And then they're the ones who send it to Congress through the Office of the President, DBM. No? When they did that, wala pang Delta variant. So the budget they gave to us had no allowances for health workers. They didn't have funds for testing, for tracing. So medyo kulang-kulang. No? And that's understandable because in June, July, the cases, I think, were going down. And then, of course, we had to lock down because of the Delta variant. Mabilis kumalat yung COVID. Apektado tayong lahat. So now, the budget that the Senate found, we had to make a lot of adjustments for health. We had to find 51 billion for our health workers. We tried to add to both the testing. There was no money for contact tracing also, which is still quite important. Important component, no? Kahit bakunado na po yung karamihan. Of course, for the few cases left, you still need to trace to prevent the spread of COVID, no? So things like that. So that's why for me the 2022 budget is still very much a health budget and an economic recovery budget. So I think those are the two aspects that we try to concentrate on.
Senator, some NGOs have described the budget as a budget with misplaced priorities. Would you agree?
Well, misplaced makes it sound like it's intentional. But yun nga, it was done when, I don't think it was done in bad faith because wala pa yung Delta nun eh. So when agencies submitted their budgets to the DBM for approval, there was no Delta variant. So it was mistargeted. I think mistargeted is a better word than misplaced because they thought we would already be back to normal by 2022. They did not expect perhaps that there would be this many cases, and of course the economy would be in the shape we're in right now.
Okay, let's talk about the DOH. How much is the Senate targeting in terms of the budget of the DOH?
Well, we practically doubled the budget of the DOH because we added about 50 billion for yung SRA or the special risk allowance of the health workers. Health worker contracts COVID, and then their benefits. It's like a hazard pay also. There's hazard pay there for the health workers. You know, they went on strike sometime this year, no? I think sometime in the third quarter. Nag-strike sila, no? Because they weren't receiving that on time. So we had to provide for that because the last thing you want is a collapse of your health system and not enough health workers manning your hospitals and clinics.
So, no, Senator, where did you get the budget for the DOH budget to be doubled?
Well, we had to, that's why at our level, we cannot just add because constitutionally we're prevented from increasing the budget ceiling. We have to maintain the budget ceiling, but what we have the power to do is reprioritize and realign from different departments. So that's what we did. We had to take some funds from here and there in the budget and to come up with this additional budget for the DOH. So okay. The DOH has a budget of That's why the health budget now, in past years, it was maybe number four, number five, number six in the top 10 funded departments and priorities. Number one is always education. Second is infrastructure. And then in the past years, third or fourth would be defense or in DILG or other departments. Now it's health that's number three. So your top three are education, infrastructure, and health, which is, I think, you know, it's hard to argue with those priorities because those priorities really help a lot of people. And whether you're in a city setting, tulad, kahit nakatira ka sa Manila, nakatira ka sa Cebu, sa Davao, mahirap mag-argue kasi ang dami natutulungan nun eh. So that's what we did. And we bumped up the budget for health by providing for allowances, for hiring of new nurses, for increasing the salaries of nurses, for putting additional funds for testing, for contact tracing, for booster vaccines. Congress also added for that. So yon, I think we're prepared in case, hopefully it doesn't happen, Karen, in 2022. And hopefully, medyo smooth sailing na tayo after we've vaccinated a great percentage of our population. And we've achieved a certain degree of immunity that we don't have to have these massive lockdowns anymore. Okay. More granular, more targeted lockdowns. But if there should be a variant akin to the Delta variant, we won't be caught off guard. We have... We have protection for us, and the government is prepared to help its people. And what we did also, Karen, is we added funds in certain departments that would. It's no longer the ayuda that you saw in Bayanihan 1 and 2, where you know if you lock down, you give to every Filipino family. Wala na kasing ganung concept. What we did is we put some in the DOLE for those who need temporary employment. We put money in the DSWD for a little bit of ayuda. Then you have food allowance also, feeding for the students. Then we put funds in the DA and the DOTR, the Department of Transport and the Department of Agriculture. These are for sectors which are affected by the high price of crude oil. So these are some of the interventions.
All right. Now, Senator, you did a bold move by actually slashing the budget of the NTFL-CAC. And you already have Senator Bato de la Rosa saying that with that slash, the NPA wins, or we're going to see a proliferation of the NPA in the countryside. Do you believe the NTFL-CAC should be abolished given their bad performance?
No, I don't think so. I think it's way too early to make that judgment for the NTF. For the NTFL-CAC, that only started to receive a budget in 2020 and a very small one at that for a nationwide program. It was really scaled up for 2021. So it got a budget of around $1 billion for 2020. Then for 2021, the budget is, I think, is $19 billion. And because maybe of the lockdowns, we cut it. The real reason we cut it is because there was no report forthcoming. Their only report to us was it's been 100% released by the DBM to the local government units all over the country. So the senators were not satisfied with that kind of an accounting of how the funds were spent. We'd like to know what projects were funded because it's a lump sum. So and the local government units would pick whether they want roads, whether they want water systems. We don't know because we don't have any information on these projects. Maaring nasa Facebook site yan ng NTFL-CAC, but they should give us a comprehensive report. That's what I told Secretary Esperon, the National Security Advisor, who serves as the Vice Chair of the NTFL-CAC. You know, you receive a new program, and we took a leap of faith this year by giving you really big funds in a time of COVID. The least you could do is give us a good reporting or accounting of how the funds were spent, because it's very hard to source funds right now, especially for the health response. And he said he would comply in the coming days. So I think it would fund over 2,000 projects all over the country in different barangays. And it's a good concept, really, Karen, no? Because you're helping poor barangays, which were once under the control of insurgents, whether it's the NPA or whether it's in Mindanao under a different armed groups, no? So Yun talaga, I think it's still a good idea because, you know, I used to represent Aurora in and there used to be a lot of communist rebels in our place at one time in the 70s, 1980s. And okay. Really what Senator, I think what yeah. our experience is that what caused the what you call rebel returnees, no? Former rebels to return to the fold and magbagong buhay sila, di na sila be part of the armed struggle is to have opportunities available to them. Nakikita nila na mararamdaman nila yung gobyerno sa kanilang lugar dahil malalayong lugar ito eh. Dapat maayos yung kalsada, magkaroon ng tubig, magkaroon ng kuryente, magkaroon ng paaralan. I think these are all very worthy. The concept is really hard to argue with. The battle against insurgency is never a battle just of armed struggle. It's also a battle for the hearts and minds of people, Karen.
Okay, but Senator, you don't consider this as a duplication of the mandate of other departments?
It is a duplication to a certain extent because there is a department which does classrooms. There is a department which does roads. There is a department which does bridges and water systems, but there is no program which zeroes in on these areas alone. So if they had to compete for projects with other cities and municipalities and provinces which don't have armed insurgents or were not previously under the control of armed insurgents, baka there's no guarantee they would get funded. So this is a program which I think is good in the sense that it really zeroes in, and it's a I think the two good things about it, Karen, is that number one, it is bottom up, meaning it's the local government officials, the barangay officials. And of course, the barangay is the most basic political unit in the country. So it's really, when you talk about the barangay, you're talking maybe about in the province, siguro a few thousand people, no?
Yeah.
And they get to decide their own destiny. They get to decide what their community wants. For me, that's a good thing. And the second is that it's a multi-pronged approach. The NTF-LCAC is not just the security advisor. It's also the DAR, it's the DA, it's the DepEd, it's the DPWH, it's the DOE.
Yeah. Senator.
And they're supposed to provide all of the services which the community needs, which is good. Oh. But having said that, we want to see a good execution of a good concept.
Yeah. Senator, you've described the 4 billion pesos that's been allotted to the NTF-LCAC as a blind allocation, considering that they've only actually 26 out of 2,318 projects. Critics have said, do they even deserve the funding? It's such...
Well, that's what we have to see, no? Because we're at an early stage of the budget for the Senate, because the preparation of the committee report, when you get it out of the committee and you report it to the plenary, is still to be debated upon by the senator. So there's still it's still early in the game. I think there's about 3 or 4 weeks left in the budget process for the year before we actually finalize the budget to be given. So there's still the bicameral, there's still the period of amendments, there's the bicameral conference. So it could go either way, depending on how they justify. So that's why I told Secretary Esperon, give us a good accounting. And because it's a new project, so we cannot just give you huge amounts of money and you have no accomplishment to speak of. Because
Senator,
we do that for all the government agencies.
Senator, with the performance of the NTF-LCAC in terms of implementation, is it possible that it will get a zero budget?
Is it possible? And hindi naman siguro, because I think it's a good project, so you should give it still a little bit of funding, no? The level will just depend on now at least they're starting to give reports, but the reports are just like a one liner of this is the project. You know, we want more details, like can you show us what were the projects that were 100% accomplished, which are the projects which are 50% accomplished, what are the completion dates, what are the exact locations of these projects, you know? All agencies have to do this, Karen. They have to justify their budget for the next year, and it's really all over the world. I think it's the same, you know. If you have a budget, you have to defend it, and if you receive the budget, you have to account for it. Otherwise, you know, you have like the commission audit will go after you, and Congress, of course, is also that's one of its crucial functions to exercise these powers during the time of the budget.
Senator, some medical frontliners raised the concern that the budget for booster shots, which is at 45.5 billion, are coming from unprogrammed funds.
That's not a problem, Karen, because the budget natin for vaccines this year, the 70 billion, was also in the unprogrammed, but it was funded right away. So, you know, at the time we passed the, maybe this time last year, the critics were also saying, ay, hindi mapondohan yan dahil nasa unprogrammed yan. And mm-hmm. and it was funded. So I think that issue's not a non-issue.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Another concern raised was it was described as a budget that did not prepare for face-to-face classes. How will that change?
That's true. That's why, you know, in the Senate, the chair of the subcommittee of the Finance Committee is Senator Pia. And she worked with our two education chairpersons, Senator Sherwin and Senator Joel Villanueva. And they're all pushing for face-to-face resumption because they note the opinion of experts that there are negative effects for kids, even for the parents, actually. There's lost income, lost opportunities.
And we're the only country in the world right now without face-to-face.
Oh, at least unique tayo, Karen. Anyway, right? Yes. So what we had to do was place some money, a bit of funds in the DepEd, as well as in the state universities and colleges so that they can adjust. Some have to prepare for testing of both the faculty and the students. Some have to adjust their physical facilities. Some have to improve their internet as well as their ICT facilities to prepare for, you know, maybe hybrid, maybe, you know, it might not be a smooth sailing initially, no? It could be part hybrid, part resumption of face-to-face.
Mm-mm. Okay, but before I move on to another topic, our reporter is watching and asking, hindi ba nagagamit sa politika ang NTFL-CAC budget?
Politika hindi eh. Election fund. Ang pumipili is the barangay. It's not like a candidate will say, or the candidate of the administration will say, oh, ito ang gusto kong mapondohan, dito ko gusto ilagay. These barangays have already been chosen. And whether or not these barangays are for a certain candidate or not, they will be given those projects. So there is no possibility of arbitrariness by taking out that barangay from a non-supporter and giving it to a supporter. I think that's what, there is a criterion. They're transparent about who the recipients are. There is a listing.
Okay, Senator, I lead and some other NGOs have criticized the budget for the priority on build. And while the intention for build is good, some have asked, is that the right pandemic response in terms of the budget? And they've criticized the performance of the DPWH and the DOTR that essentially has a 40% average release. Would you change the DPWH budget?
Well, that's a collective. That's because, you know, part of that is decided by the congressmen in their districts. They decide what's needed in their district. But what we've done also is we've put a concentration on funding the construction of new medical school facilities. So that's why the build is kind of fused to the health imperative of strengthening our health system. So you look all over the country, you have this new medical scholarship law, which was authored by Senator Joel and the Senate President, Senator Soto, which the goal is to have more doctors in the public health system and given scholarships. So of the 110 state universities and colleges, each region will have new medical schools. So a lot of the construction budget is also for the construction of new medical school facilities. And of course, UPPGH, which had a big fire a few months ago, if you remember, we need to really, as well as with the lung center and all of these specialty hospitals, you know, when there was COVID, their COVID wings were all full. And you saw people outside in their garages, in the parking lot. We don't want that. So we want to strengthen their ability to absorb also and react if there's a new virus of COVID. And of course, that's long overdue. We've always wanted to strengthen our health system. And dito naman sa, I'll just say a little bit more about infrastructure. we're finally spending around 5% of our GDP for infrastructure, Karen. Nung hindi natin ginagastos yan, nagre-reklamo ang mga tao at sinasabi, eh kulang-kulang yung ginagastos natin sa infrastructure, kaya kulelat tayo. Ngayon na ginagastos na natin, galit pa rin sila.
But I guess it's a question, what you're saying, of where. Here's a good question. There's 170 billion pesos budget cut for our ITM. Malacanang says it's no longer the lone lab testing.
Yes, there are lab tests all over. We did not cut the budget of our ITM, Karen. No.
Okay.
Maybe that's at the DBM level, but not at the Senate level. We kept the budget for it, because we know that's a very important institution.
Mm-mm.
In fact, when I got COVID, that's where I got tested. So.
Uh-oh. So you are retaining the budget of RITM. There's been thoughts also that the DOH budget is too rigid. Would you describe it that way?
Too rigid? I'm not sure what they mean, because there are funds for health personnel, there are funds for health facilities, there are funds for purchase of health medicines. What we've done is we've given them its health intervention, so it could be for testing, it could also be for, in case you know this, I forgot the name of the drug that they're giving, it's not a vaccine, but you take it orally. Monoprovir. In case that is certified by, those types of drugs are certified by the WHO, for instance, as effective, and by the FDA, as the Food and Drug Administration, if they certify that these are effective against COVID, then we should even if it's in the middle of the year, dapat may kapagkakataon tayo na bubili niyan. That's why that we've placed a certain flexibility there.
But what about the budget for the police and the military? Do you believe that there should be cuts there?
No, just maybe steady. Don't expect the usual growth in the past years, because we're trying to stabilize our economy and we're trying to firm up our health response should something akin to the Delta variant happen. So, I think we just keep our spending on that, because we also need peace and order. We also need national security. We had some aircraft crash this year. You know, we need to replace those also, Karen.
Oh, okay. What about food security? I interviewed the Department of Agriculture a few months back, and their concern was their suggested budget of 231 billion was cut down to 91 billion. So the crime...
They're still higher than their last year's budget, if I'm not mistaken, Karen. No. Those figures, when they're thrown around, they make it seem like it's such a big cut, but you should look at what was their budget from the previous year and what is their budget this year. I think they're still they've not gotten a cut from the previous year. In fact, I think they've increased. No,
Senator, though, is 1 billion only.
I think we increased that because we placed funds for the farmers who, because some of the senators, Senator Kiko is one of them, wanted to give some aid to the farmers who are suffering, because they use some of their tractors are mechanized, so they use a lot of crude oil, gasoline also. So we want to assist them somehow.
Okay, now part of this COVID recovery budget that you're planning or you envision, you've set aside 100 to 150 billion for government assistance, right? And in an interview you did or in the Senate hearing, you said it's going to go to public utility drivers, the unemployed, farmers, health workers, indigents. How are you seeing this, Senator, considering wala nang ayuda?
Well, it's been spread out na in different departments para it's institutionalized, Karen, no? And it can go straight to the beneficiaries, those who need it most. Because like I said earlier in our interview, we don't foresee a widespread national lockdown that we had, like the example like we had in March, April 2020. That's the time we really needed to lock down nationally and give SAP, ayuda to all Filipino families. Di na mangyari siguro yon. We really need to hit the people who've been hit the hardest, no? We really need to reach the people who've been hit the hardest. So that's why it's lodged in different departments. DA for the farmers, DOTR for the PUV drivers and operators, CHED and the state universities, and DepEd for the students, And then DOH for the health interventions, DOLE for those who need employment, TESDA for those who need training, among others.
Okay, another question here. The President's Intelligence and Confidential Funds, is it still at 4.5 billion?
We didn't touch it. So whatever the executive proposed, we did not increase it. It's still at the same level.
All right. Last word, Senator Sunny Angara. What are you foreseeing for 2022?
It's hard to say, you know, but I think things are getting better. I'm crossing my fingers. But the last 20 months has been a real roller coaster for us. No, just when we think we're getting better comes the Delta variant. So it's cyclical rather than linear. So whether it's like two steps forward, one step back. Two steps forward again, one step back. So we're prepared, and hopefully we've learned our lesson, and we don't have to lock down the whole country or big sectors of our economy, of big cities. We'll just do the granular lockdowns. I think we've learned our lesson, and we know better how to target. And that's why this 2022 budget gives the government the tools and to help our people. And have more targeted interventions, Karen.
What would you want to see as an improvement with the government's COVID response? But what would you want them to improve?
Well, we're already vaccinating a lot, no? I guess our contact tracing efforts could still use some improvement. And maybe the experts are also saying we're not testing enough. So maybe we can test a little more. There's funding for that. Other than that, I think, well, strengthening our health system, that's always a goal going forward. PhilHealth, I think, needs to improve because the hospitals are still complaining. They're not getting reimbursed in a timely manner. So
there was a concern brought up that the budget for PhilHealth is at 79 billion.
Yes,
80 some billion. Some say that wouldn't be too safe.
Well, that's 10 billion more than last year, Karen. So hopefully it's enough to cover, no? But universal healthcare was already a problem to fund even before the pandemic. So we should aim to increase that funding over time, definitely to cover the whole country.
Yeah, I'm curious. I know this is off budget already, but because you are an expert on the budget, you have presidential candidates.
Not really.
No, you have presidential candidates already calling for a cut, a 50% cut on excise taxes for next year if they win. 50% cut on electricity, 50% cut on excise tax on fuel, and clearly it would affect the revenues of the government. Are those promises possible or feasible?
Well, anything is possible, though. No? But if you cut that for a year, you'll lose about 50 to 75 billion pesos. So you just have to be prepared to lose funding for that kind. That's the equivalent of 75 billion, the equivalent of your subsidy to PhilHealth. 50 billion is what you give to the free tuition program. So, you know, there are costs to that, obviously. It's very easy to say, but you must be prepared for the consequences, I suppose.
On that note, Senator Sunny Angara, thanks for joining me today, sir. We hope to have you back.
Yes, thank you. It's always a pleasure, Karen. Thank you very much.